I come from a business analysis background and trying to get into product management. So I have about 15 years industry experience and worked across different industries and geographies. And I'm currently a student of cohort 8 at Pragmatic. And that's brief about me. I'd like to hear more from you, Lokesh. So why don't you introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure, Vinu. So I'm currently working as a senior product manager at Oracle. So the product which I'm owning is it's a tech-like router product. So I'm currently taking care of outbound related product management aspects, that is like product line management role. And before Oracle, I was part of Shield Square. So in Shield Square, I was working as a product manager there. There I was working both inbound and outbound product management aspects. So in Shield Square, it's like a bot management product. We solve like content scraping use cases, price scraping, web scraping use cases. We solve this use case for e-commerce customers. And before Shield Square, I was part of Credit Mantri. It's similar to Bank Bazaar, Paisa Bazaar, Policy Bazaar in India. It's like a fintech portal. Before Credit Mantri, I did an MBA from SPGen Institute of Management Research. It's a one-year full-time MBA. So major in information management and minor in marketing. And as part of the curriculum, we also had an immersion program with the University of Texas, Austin. So where we had a chance to go to UT Austin Mecom School of Business, and we had three credit subjects there. In UT Austin, and before UT Austin, I was working with Symantec. So Symantec, it's an antivirus. It's like for B2C and B2B product, like both retail security and enterprise security. So before Symantec, I was a part of Accenture, working for British Telecommunications. So this is my.
Okay, cool. You've given the entire in reverse chronological.
Yeah,
I think. I think I was also thinking a similar approach in terms of start with the most recent one. But before we even do that, I just wanted to ask your first impressions on product management as a career. Like, when did you first come across the term, and how did you get interested in product management as a career?
Yeah. So as I was saying before, I was working with Symantec. So in Symantec, I was doing a QA engineering role there. For almost 4 years, I was working with Symantec. There, I got an opportunity to interact with product management people there. So one of my the interest where I got motivated is like there is a product management guy called Joel Joseph. He did his MBA from Kelly School of Business, and he's doing fantastic job in product management in Symantec. So that triggered my passion to product management there. So that's the starting point in Symantec, and from there I started intriguing, or maybe started deep diving, like what is product management and who are all product managers. There I got to know like about Sundar Pichai, Ray Doffman, Marisa Mayer, and a lot many folks who are been in product and become a CEO and all. And so that's a trigger point there. At that time, Sundar Pichai didn't become CEO, he was like a VP PM there. Yeah. So those are my trigger points to become a product manager.
Okay, that's very interesting. And since you mentioned especially that background in Symantec, I think it's kind of very relevant. I think you have this very unique combination of product management and cybersecurity. I know for the purposes of this talk, we are really more interested in product management, but cybersecurity is another, you know, such a hot area. So you must be really, really sought after talent. So, so maybe I'll ask you this as well. So did you land in cybersecurity on purpose, or was it just happened?
It's by accident only. So I was looking for an opportunity to get into a product company. when I was working from Accenture, and I'm planning to shift from service to product company. So I was just looking to get an opportunity to work for a product company. That's it. So and then accidentally it happened. So I got an opportunity to work with Symantec.
So I think another kind of related one is that to understand really the nuances of product management, right?
Right.
So you mentioned you've been in services, and then you've made the shift to the product, and also you've had that bit of that startup exposure as well as and now you're in a really really large conglomerate kind of a thing.
Talk us through
how product management changes in these contexts, right?
So as I was saying, I was working with Symantec, and then I did an MBA. So during an MBA, most of my senior recommended me to do an internship. So I was reaching out to startups predominantly to get a product management internship. So with my cybersecurity background, I fortunately got an opportunity to work with InstaSafe as a product management intern. So that is also a startup, InstaSafe, and that exposure gave me an opportunity or gate pass to work with Shield Square. So both InstaSafe CEO and Shield Square CEO are very good friends, and that's how I landed in Shield Square. And yeah, so coming to startup, product management startup and product management in the larger organization, in Shield Square we have to do both inbound and outbound product management aspects. It's like inbound and outbound, meaning so inbound we have to write the user stories, roadmaps, everything, like the technical product management aspects we have to take care, and the outbound product management aspects like conducting webinar, writing marketing collaterals. So all those things has to be done by a product management in both aspects has to be taken care in Shield Square. Whereas in Oracle, I worked in two different teams. The first part in Oracle is like Oracle Cloud Infrastructure product I worked with there. So there, it's like entirely we have to focus like it's like a TPM role only. Like a technical product management role, we have to just focus. We don't need to focus on outbound product management. There is a separate team for it.
Okay.
And whereas in the second team, like the current team which I'm part of, like it's a Oracle Communications Group business unit that is networking product. Here I'm taking care of product line management responsibilities. So here I don't need to work on technical product management aspects. So in Oracle it's like different, and in Shield Square you have to do both. If you work with Shield Square, then there'll be like a lot of resource constraints. You won't get engineering resources quickly onboarded. So we'll have like bandwidth constraints, like in terms of funding shortage, everything we have to undergo. Those challenges will be there. Whereas in Oracle, you will have like a lot of people, like principal software engineers, like senior principal software engineers, senior directors, who are directly having hands-on coding experience, and we can quickly onboard them to our projects, and those constraints won't be there in Oracle. So that's a major difference I have seen both working in startup and the bigger company. And the good aspect in Shield Square also, it's like you will get exposed to interact with Gartner, Forrester analysts, whereas in Oracle the director PMs, most of them would be interacting with Gartner and Forrester analyst calls.
That's great. I think that's a good segue for the benefit of users to kind of dwell deep into that other kind of difference. You talked about the inbound and outbound kind of thing.
Right.
Also, yes, there are so many flavors of product management, right? And then there are plenty of people in different forums asking kind of similar questions in terms of, you know, differences between product ownership and product management, and also sort of being the technical person in charge of delivery of a product versus being a sort of more of marketing person, you know. So there are those differences. I think again you've got that really that blend of all those areas, you know. So how did that happen? And maybe just talk us through the journey. Which one you say is your strength? Which one did you start with, and how did you sort of develop some of the other areas?
Right. So one of my strength is like I'm very good in doing market research, and so that this was given as a good appreciation from CEO of Shield Square. So I'm very much good in doing market research and doing competitive analysis, and those aspects were my area of strengths. And the other area of improvements which they my CEO suggested is like I have to be one step ahead with the in the competitor analysis itself, like what competitors will foresee the features. I have to be abreast or ahead, and then I have to come up with features. So those aspects I was a little bit lagging. That also my CEO suggested in that aspect. And then so market research was my area of strength. So that was my key focus thing, and I'm good at
Okay, so that obviously falls under more of an outfacing, market
right.
facing kind of role.
Right.
But given your technical background, it's very interesting. Again, you seem to have both the strengths actually. Good. So another frequently asked question is obviously how beneficial is it for a product manager to have a technical background, particularly if the product that you're actually working on has some technology aspect to it,
right?
You mentioned earlier that you kind of accidentally landed in this. So was domain a key thing when you moved from one role to another, or talk us through that as
So I will talk from my experience. So it's like the domain is the key thing to get into to get into these roles, and like say getting an internship itself was from InstaSafe. That was Symantec played a crucial role in getting an internship there, and then getting into Credit Mantri there, the product management intern title and then MBA played a good role into in getting to the role of Credit Mantri. But after getting into Credit Mantri, I could not I could not sustain long for 6 months because the banking or fintech exposure is very low to me, so I couldn't do well in there in Credit Mantri. That's where I got an opportunity, or I thought of shifting to cybersecurity product itself, and there that's where I got into Shield Square. So in Shield Square also, while selecting my CEO appreciated my cybersecurity background, and that's where I got selected. The basic profile shortlist itself will happen if you have a good domain background, and then in Oracle Cloud infrastructure, it's a Palera cybersecurity product. It's called as Cloud Access Security Broker. So that also came with cybersecurity domain experience. And in my personal aspect, if you don't have domain experience, it's very tough to survive in this B2B security products. It's very challenging to start from scratch, and because you have to give the requirements to engineers, and then if they ask a lot of questions to you, it's very tough to counter them. And without domain experience, domain expertise, it's not easy to survive here in this sort of products. You can survive in like B2C products, like fintech products and all, you can survive. But in B2B cybersecurity and all, without domain experience, it's very tough.
Okay. That's very interesting that you mentioned. Yes, I think I have the same opinion, particularly around the cybersecurity industry. But having said that, it's really a very intriguing situation because you're looking at that market worldwide. Mm-hmm. And it's really growing. I mean, the need for cybersecurity analysts and experts of all sorts of, be it network kind of people or be it software, be it any kind of role in cybersecurity, the demand seems to be really skyrocketing, right? And I think the industry...
And given given the GDPR and last year European Union regulation has put a like rule like GDPR,
yeah.
and then like California privacy law is coming in place. So yeah. that creates a huge demand for cybersecurity related products.
Yeah, yeah, data absolutely. Products, yeah. I'll give a bit of an Aussie flavor to it, maybe because I'm in Melbourne. I'm observing a kind of a pattern here wherein government organizations, apart from the businesses, like the large businesses, of course, like the banks, always have an eye on this area. But you wouldn't think of government as so much of a target. But, you know, often when it comes to security threats, the government organizations are ending up being targets. And it's not just the federal government or the state government, even the small councils, the local council bodies, they are actually becoming targets. I think it's even in the case with US and UK elsewhere, and Australia is no different. And I can see that they're really struggling to cope up with it. I even came across articles where somebody just had one of these ransomware, they didn't know what to do, and you know, some councils, if they don't have really that kind of either the structure in place, or even if they don't even have a single role to tackle this kind of threat, they just end up paying because, you know, their entire data is at stake. They don't know what to do. It's not a pretty scenario at all. So the reason I mentioned that is that, so given the demand, right, then obviously you got to welcome outsiders. So I'm taking that perspective because it's a very interesting thing, because I'm passionate about both these areas. I'm passionate about product management, and that's why I'm getting pragmatic. And I'm also kind of really intrigued by the scenario around cybersecurity, and it really seems to be an area that's going to come under a lot of focus in the next probably decade, I would say.
Further.
So if that is the case, when somebody who's an outsider to the industry, you're talking about you know, how hard it is, I think, from your own experience,
you
don't have the domain to get in. This seems to be really a bad combination, right? How do you see, if somebody is aspiring, so how do you see them picking up something around the cybersecurity? Are there any academic courses, or are there other ways of upskilling?
Yeah, so there are certifications related to cybersecurity. One such certifications I can recommend is CISSP. It's a very good certification, and most of the folks in sales or pre-sales or product management in cybersecurity, they used to do this certification, CISSP. It covers the entire gamut of the cybersecurity aspects, right from regulation aspects or how different product portfolios are there in cybersecurity. The entire basics would be covered in the certification CISSP. It's a little bit costly, the training wise also, and the exam wise also, it's very costly. And if you just prepare for that exam itself, you can have a very good solid understanding on cybersecurity. And right now, given that cloud is being emerging, so there is another certifications related to it. It's with respect to cloud security. It's called CCSP. So it's all given by the same board, certification board. The CCSP is like Certified Cloud Security Professional. So that is also, it's an emerging one. It's an upgraded flavor of CISSP. So those things are really you get a very good fundamentals of cybersecurity and basics of cybersecurity with the certifications. And once you get that certification, definitely you can crack into any cybersecurity companies. That I can guarantee that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
All right. So just moving on from cybersecurity to just product management. Obviously, you mentioned domain. That has been a key factor. But other than domain, in terms of product management maturity, right? I know different markets are at different levels of maturity. Again, from my experience here in Australia over the last 4 or 5 years, I see that typically the market lags, say the US market or the UK market by a few years. It could be like about 5 to 10 years, depending on which area you are looking at. So so there is this aspect of maturity. Again, maybe you can give that bit of that Indian perspective, I think, because you've spent quite a bit of time there.
Right.
And also Oracle being global, you know, how do you see that in terms of product management practices? What's the kind of maturity that you're observing?
So in terms of market aspects, in selling deep tech products, while working on Shield Square, there is like a little bit of gap we see in understanding the use cases and all from Indian market. So that's why we started positioning our whole product towards US and Europe only, and we didn't cater to like Asian countries. We didn't target. So the whole product is targeted to US and Europe. And the only benefit we foresee starting here in India, it's like we get resources for cheap, and when compared to developing the deep tech product in US, the cost benefit advantage we had. And that's the good thing we have foreseen. But in terms of if you it's very tough to sell in Indian market. That's my point here. When compared to US and Europe, because these are like Shield Square, it's a deep tech product. It's similar to we solve, like as I said, like content scraping, web scraping, price scraping, yeah. All these use cases. It's very tough to understand here also. So the pain point is not relevant in India. In the US, it was there. One thing, and with respect to OCI, the demand is all over world, and from OCI also the demand is majorly, it's predominantly in US and Europe. That's my perspective on market in the products which I have.
Okay. Just digging on that a little deeper, right? So the process followed for those markets. You might have done maybe the product development in India, but you still got to do your customer development sort of activities. You earlier touched on market research, so you need to do the market research kind of activities in that market. I'm not sure if you really work remotely all the time, or how did you work on those aspects? And I believe it was a B2B kind of a segment.
B2B.
How did you go about understanding that market so that you can come up with your product roadmap? Things like that.
Understood. So you are asking like how would I interact with the customers?
Yeah.
How would I interact in getting the requirements and all those aspects?
Yes.
That too working remotely.
Yeah.
So we will be working remotely, and we have like our sales folks and customer success management folks who have like frequent interaction with the customers. And in Shield Square, it's like for every sales call, we used to, there will be like a pre-sales, customer success and sales people will be there, and then in the sales meeting we used to, and as a product managers, we used to attend very important meetings. Like if there are like 50 customers and we just focus on top 5 customers or top 10 customers, or like based on different use cases or based on different geography, we focus, and we just focus those customers, and we go on a call with them, and then we get requirements, we jot down requirements, and then we elaborate as on user stories, and then it's transferred to engineering folks or engineering team members. And rest of the inputs we just gather through email, where the customer success team members say, hey, I interacted with this customer X, they are asking for a feature Y. Then we'll add it to a feature dump or a feature backlog. Yeah. And then we based on the prioritization criteria, we pick this feature, and we'll develop it and ship those features.
That's a very hotly debated thing, isn't it? I've read different articles on this. When a customer asks for a feature, and then you're straight away doing it, that's kind of your sales-driven kind of an approach. And
it may not be
sort of the best thing. Especially as the startup, sometimes you got to do if it's a matter of your survival and you've got only a few customers. But it can be a different in other contexts. So maybe talk us through that aspect a little bit deeper.
Yeah. So this is where like the feature prioritization criteria comes here. The feature prioritization in Shield Square, how we did, it's like which customer is asking, and what's their revenue potential. Say if a customer is 1000 MRR, 1000 monthly recurring revenue dollar potential, or is it like 20,000 MRR account, which customer is asking and what's their revenue potential number. That's the number one thing. And number two, what feature they're asking and what's the engineering feasibility to do that. So that feature might take 6 months to develop for an engineering team, or maybe 3 months. What's the engineering feasibility? And then do we have really capable engineers? Say if you take on integration aspects, in B2B aspects, say if they are asking for Varnish plugin or any WordPress plugin integration, do we have engineering resources capable to build that feature? So we have to evaluate that. And then the fourth, is there any regulation aspects? Regulation aspects meaning GDPR, PCI, HIPAA, and other compliance aspects involved in this feature. Number four and number five is like, if you develop this feature, can it bring more customers for us?
Yeah.
How it brings more revenue for us in terms of like how other customers are interested in this feature. So like this five. Like this criteria, we will mark it as a score like 1 to 5. And then the cumulative score, we'll pick it as the highest one, and then we'll develop the feature.
Okay.
This is why
ranking mechanism.
This is how we develop features in Sheetsware. Whereas in Oracle Cloud Infrastructure, it's a different ball game. So it's a set prioritization criteria comes from BPM level. And then we have to follow this prioritization.
Okay, because somebody has probably done all that exercise. Maybe it's time, since you touched on the Oracle thing, maybe you can talk us through how things work there in a bit more detail. You mentioned that you're doing more outbound kind of focused role. So again, it being such a global organization, maybe talk us through how the product management is split, because in large organizations, if the product itself is huge, sometimes as a product manager, you might be only taking care of a really small part of the feature that you actually own. And there are lots of other ways of splitting it, vertical, horizontal, etc., etc. So maybe talk us through a little bit about how product management practices work at Oracle if somebody is aspiring for a role.
So as I said before, there is inbound product management, outbound product management here in Oracle, in the two teams which I work, and depends on the business unit or depends on the product which you are working in Oracle, there are different practices also they are following. There are folks I have where my batchmate is working as a PM. He used to do coding. He used to do coding to develop POCs, and then the POCs will be developed and deployed in the customer environment also. So there are coding aspects involved in product management in Oracle in few teams. The teams which I work Oracle Cloud Infrastructure and Oracle Networking team, in both inbound and outbound is there. With respect to how the team is structured, it's there will be 10 PMs. In 10 PMs, there will be two directors, and the two directors will be reporting to one VP. And if there are 10 different app integration has to be done, so there will be two PMs or two apps mapped to one PM. So if you take Oracle Cloud Infrastructure for an example, there are SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS apps. We have to give security for it, or OCI security, I'm trying to say. And for SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS, there will be different. Say for example, SaaS G Suite application is there, and Salesforce application is there, Office 365 application is there. So there will be two applications will be handled by one PM in terms of technical aspects alone. And this is how the technical PM is structured. And so there'll be two PMs who is just focusing only on outbound aspects. He'll be writing data sheets. he'll be writing, he'll be working on webinar aspects. In the OCI security team, there was no marketing manager assets. Everything has to be done by a product management team itself. So that's how it has been structured in OCI. Here in networking team, it's like four TPMs will be working on one particular use case. One particular use case, and four will be mapped to one PLM. That is the one outbound product. That's how it has been structured. So this PLM has to validate whether these folks will be saying like, I'm going to develop this feature, so we have to validate whether this feature X it's bringing so much amount of revenue to us. So we will question them and validate them like it's whether it's good to go or not. So we'll be like a check post for all these features, and then we'll be validating those.
That's before it goes to development, right?
Exactly. Okay. There'll be a lot of features requests coming from sales also. Yeah. Whether they have done proper prioritization, we also have to validate all those things.
Interesting. Okay. So as you were talking through that, I had this question, especially in this kind of a large organization context, often it's very hard to kind of even fathom what exactly is the product.
Okay.
So maybe talk us through that, you know. So in your context, what exactly is the product and sort of how does that break down?
Right. So in terms of what do you mean by products, like X plus Y plus Z feature that makes a product.
Yeah.
Or maybe X plus Y plus Z Z level apps that makes a product. Apps meaning the integration aspects and all I'm trying to say.
Yep.
So this X, Y, Z will be taken care by each product manager.
Yep.
That is the level of action they will work in an org. And in Shield Square also, it's not like one PM handling the entire product. So there are like three PMs handling the product management in Shield Square. It's like ad fraud use case will be handled by a separate PM, and then dashboard integration aspects will be handled by separate PM, and then bot management rule engine and ML aspects, data science aspects, and then the front end aspects, all these things will be handled by separate PM. So in Shield Square it has been structured like that. In Oracle it has been structured like this.
Interesting. So there's no, obviously there's no one
one, yeah, no, it's not
expressed or anything.
Yeah. Okay. maybe a VP PM will be handling a separate product that we can say, yeah, handling a single whole product. Yeah.
I think with that we'll wrap up. I think it was amazing to hear all those things. I don't know who else is going to tune into this in terms of technology. I'm sure a lot of people, but I think I'm going to tune in myself and listen to it a couple of times at least, because you've shared a lot for us. Thanks so much for the time. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks Vinu. Thanks for your time. Thanks. It's an amazing questions and it's a very good discussion with you.